that's what the subcommittee needs to talk about a little bit too, and just come back to fulfill the recommendation, how to proceed. But I think that some interesting things were learned that could be helpful. And I think that maybe the biggest conclusion, and again, we'll come back with it, is that all the training that these groups get is on procurement, not on disposal. So it's an unknown territory in a lot of ways. Okay, sounds good. Let's roll on to enterprise funds. Yes.
Yes.
So do you want to throw this one hand up for today?
It's got the page numbers EF, EF2, EF1.
I explained in this memo why I printed it. There's very little that's changed. As I go through, I'll mention those changes. Just so you know. The page EF2 is kind of an overview. I think the important things to glean from this page, if you look at that column, the table on the left, it's called surplus. All three enterprise funds have extremely healthy reserves for a variety of reasons, some of which won't repeat themselves in the future. That gives the selectmen a lot of flexibility in using reserves to offset rates.
Okay.
And the general philosophy is to look at the MWRA charges and offset those because we have no control over those. MWRA normally forecasts 3 to 5 years out, eventually. If you look at that paragraph on the left, water and sewer, MWRA assessments are significantly more important to the sewer budget. You can see it's almost 80% of the sewer costs. So pretty much whatever the MWRA assessment is what the sewer rates are going to be. There's not a lot we can do with the local levy. If you look at that graph on the lower right-hand side, you can see that in the last 5 years, with one exception, rates have been reasonably well-behaved in the 2 to 4% a year in the area, if that's reasonable. And the 10% or more increase was 90% of that was due to a volume change assumption. So just to go over that quickly, because it's a little counterintuitive. A lot of the budget is fixed. Certainly the MWRA assessment is not, but that's like if you have debt service, you sell 10 gallons of water, and then the next year you sell 9 gallons of water. Well, guess what? Your rate's going up, because you didn't sell as much water. So on the one hand, we're obliged to encourage people to conserve water, use less. Technically, I'm part of the people who are supposed to do that, but I keep telling people to use water. Don't use water. If you use more water, rates will go up. That's just perverse. That's just the way it is. Now, the thing that it's difficult to explain to residents is the water bill is not the same as the water rate. So if you cut your usage in half and rates go up 25%, you're using less money to pay for the water. So we do have to track usage. It's more of an art than a science. We have now 10 years of good history, and there's 2 summers where usage just spiked because of droughts. But the weather didn't indicate that those should have been the 2 years. It just didn't. So for some reason, it's probably a combination of what people are paying plus what the weather's like. If your rates only went up a couple percent, then you might use the water. If it went up 15%, maybe you don't. I can't figure it out. But the point this year is there will have to be another smaller adjustment in order to usage.
This annual combined, is that after our reserves have been applied, or is that straightly?
Yes. Okay. That's actually rates. So that is net of everything. Budgets, reserves, and the selectmen are having a hearing next Tuesday night on rates. Generally speaking, they're in the 2% area, 0 to 2% area. If you look at page EF3.
Sorry, just to clarify, yep. I think I'm a little bit confused. So if usage goes down, rates go up, is that in order to meet the MWRA assessment?
No, just to pay your debt service, for instance.
Okay.
Rates have to be set on the amount of water sold. budget is fixed, more or less. Now, if you use less water this year, next year, your charge will go down, but in your current year, your budget is fixed. It is what it is. You take a guess at how much water you're gonna sell, and then you set your rates based on what that guess is. One year, we had a revenue shortfall where our guess was wrong. We didn't sell as much water as we estimated, so we weren't collecting the revenue in to pay for the budget that everyone passed. So we actually had to go to town meeting in April and do a reserve fund transfer for a revenue deficit, which is unusual. That was the only time I can remember in 20 years that that happened. So as a result, you want to be a little bit cautious and conservative when you're forecasting usage and assume there'll be more conservation than you think there really will be, just so you don't have a revenue deficit. Now, the other side of that could be, and we saw it 3 or 4 years ago, your collections also slows because people decide they don't want to pay their water sewer bill and let it go to the tax bill and get liens. And eventually it's going to cost them a lot more, but the point is we don't collect in the meanwhile. So you have to pay the bills. Again, you have to have some assumption based on economic circumstances of uncollectible bills for the short term.
Thanks for the clarification. Yes, thank you.
I have a question. What happens if usage exceeds expectations?
You collect a lot more money and your reserves go up. So it's not a bad thing. I mean, in theory, we're not trying to chart a profit, so that would mean rates can be lower next year.
Thank you.
And one question about the financial emergencies. We're holding those reserves for general town financial emergencies or somehow water and sewer?
Well, enterprise fund emergencies. So if the water main broke, yeah. On page EF3, just to talk a little more about MWRA assessments, if you look at line W5, this year the MWRA assessment for water is up 5.3%. And if you, wander to the right there, 5, 8, and 3% over the next few years. That was not unexpected, that 5%. Where we really got very lucky was the S5, the sewer, which again is a much bigger number and a much more significant number. Was only up 0.6% for Reading. But as you can see, in the next couple of years, 6 and 7% and 5%, it's going to be a lot tougher to have a elevated rate. So you can see from a budget standpoint, the budgets are actually down 2%. Now, I mentioned we have to do that volume adjustment, which is why rates will go up slightly, go up a couple percent. But that gives you an overview, if you will, of the enterprise funds. And then stormwater is tagging along at the bottom. Well behaved at $40 a household. We'll talk about that shortly too. I'll do each enterprise fund fairly quickly and just point out some things that have changed, but please slow me down or ask questions.
I guess just
a big
picture question. So enterprise funds growth was
for, from a transparency for the consumer, or why?
I'm recommending it from an aggravation standpoint. Customers, when they miss the deadline by a day, you'd have thought it's the end of the world upstairs in the collections department. What do you mean, I meant to be here, it's just awful.
Is it going to be the same issue, is it going to be essentially the same issue, though, if there's...
No, because if they miss it by a day, it's 14% a year, what's the big difference? It's a couple bucks. So what we find is, you know, that cutoff is, the collections are amazing. The amount of collections that happen within one or two days at that period, we don't have the staff to handle it. So we've caused it artificially to all compress into that really short timeframe. We have to have all hands on deck from this end of the building for a couple days every quarter.
Will it still compress, though, if you get rid of it, in theory, right? It could just as easily compress, it'll slide to the tail end and then compress there, because...
I don't think so.
Hopefully not as much.
It will compress the same way, only based on how real estate taxes are paid and excise taxes. You know, it's much more spread out, okay, I'm a couple days late, I'm 7 days late, what's the real difference? But that one day on 10% of your water and sewer bill is a lot of money, especially in the summer.
Is that going to cause more hassles, though, as people are there too late, and they get a 50-cent interest charge, they're going to come back and study? Can you waive that?
They are, by state law, the treasurer can waive a nominal amount, so it's, I remember, $10 or $15, whatever it is, we always waive that, so that shouldn't be a problem. But there is the town meeting demand fee of, I can't remember, I think it's $50. Again, on an excise tax bill, that's tough, when your excise tax bill is $18.75, but on a water sewer bill, it's going to be a lot lower than the 10% increase would have been of the discount you lost. So the key is really for everyone to understand, everybody gets the 10% discount, and then something else happens.
Has there been any discussion? I've heard a lot, I personally heard a lot about it from people, about the second meters and what that would do to rates, you know, honestly, you know, a ton of people ask me this question all the time, like, what would it matter? And I don't know the answer.
A recent board of selectmen took that up and voted, no, we're not going to have second meters.
Okay.
That's kind of historical. Aside from any operational challenges, there's a certain amount of money we have to collect to get run water and sewer. So if you have a second meter for your water in the home, generally speaking, that would not have a sewer charge. That means sewer rates for everyone else is going to have to go up. So right now, if you will, people who are watering their lawn are paying a little more in sewer charges than maybe they're not using. But the money's going to come from somewhere. So that's actually an interesting question. When the selectmen last discussed this, I think it was 2 years ago, we did a pretty extensive survey.
Yeah.
And it was almost dead right down the middle, 50-50, as to those that did or did not allow second meters. But the trend was going away from them.
Yeah, I used to know usage.
Because it was meant to discourage people, you know, you're supposed to encourage conservation. So giving them a break on the sewer portion of that bill was encouraging people to, you know, sprinkle their lawns.
Except for the fact that, like you said, usage was up, you end up in a better position for the town. I know it's counterintuitive, and I get it, but
I guess what we found is it doesn't affect usage. If you have a sprinkler system, you're going to use it. It's just a question of what you're paying. Now, maybe for someone putting one in, they would think about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would think it would increase usage, because, I mean, if you think about the portion of
that
sewage that you're billing, like, you know, the water, like you said, it's what, like 70-30, I don't even know what you're telling. It's 70-30, you'd think if you took 70% of that away, you would increase usage significantly, which would then generate...
What we've also found is the folks who install sprinkler systems somewhat understate the actual cost of what that'll be when you run the water bill. And so I guess I'm extremely shocked people when that first bill comes in and they're like, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
$1,200? They said it would be $300. Well, they could have asked us. So we try to get that word out. To water your lawns is very expensive.
Yes.
It just is. Yeah.
I put in a well so that when I water the lawn, I want it.
Sign.
Yeah, that's right.
Make sure you get reported. Do that.
Is there a plan to
utilize
some of the surplus in future projects?
There's a plan to utilize about half the surplus in rates over the next 3 years. there's a plan to use a big chunk of sewer in this town meeting, which I think I can talk about quickly. And then there's a plan to use, I can't remember, about a third of the excess in stormwater capital in about 3 years. So there's still some unspent, if you will, and unplanned surplus.
Yeah, but the bulk of the above target has a plan.
As far as changing from the 10% quote-unquote discount to the late fee, what would be the, say, 5 or 10 year ramifications of that if we're decreasing the amount that we're essentially putting into reserves from these funds? What's the long-term plan if we do have, say, a water main break in the reserves for whatever reason shrink?
Well, right now the reserves are so healthy that if they're going to do it and there is a financial issue that will follow, it's okay. Amount of money we're talking about is probably $100,000 to $200,000 tops. So if we go from one system to the next, that's about the difference. And we'll know within a year or two whether it really mattered. We'll see how much we collect. He's in charge of all that. It's probably fine to do it even if we didn't have healthy reserves, but we're in a position where it's really not the difference. If the board agrees, I don't know.
We have the online payment system that's been in place a couple of years, and I don't use it because I don't have to spend $5 to pay my bill when I can put a 45 cent stamp on normal. I'm just wondering, have you seen people using it?
We do. There's a couple of different options, and generally, I don't personally like any of them, but they are. As a municipality, we have to follow very different rules than most retail shops, so we can't pay the charge for it. It's illegal. Now, actually, in water and sewer, we sort of could. Real estate, absolutely not. And it really depends. The best deal out there is to pay your bills with a debit card, because then it's a fraction of a certain percent of the bill, or a fixed charge, depends on your bank. But if you pay using the online system, it's so funny because I'll describe what it's like shortly. For most bills, it's way too expensive to do that.
That's
it just
right.
Is. I think it's okay for the real estate building. But interestingly enough, what happens is, okay, you go online, you pay, you think it's really efficient. It doesn't help us at all. It's actually worse for us. Because we'll just get a batch of collections from the bank that we then have to sort out instead of getting an envelope from you. And so the automation on the bank end is generally terrible. To the customer, it looks good, and that's fine. Coming to us, it's not making us our life any easier, it's making us slightly harder. But they've got a down path, so it works pretty well.
I went on there and checked and see if the rate's still the same. Like, yep, it's still on $5. No, not doing it. So I'm like, is anybody using it? Why bother?
Yeah. Now, 3 years ago, we had a vendor who was proposing to have a really nice electronic payment system for all of our payments, for most of our payments. I loved it, and I wanted us to do a little more research, look into it. By the time we did, they were out of business. So it was probably not a very lucrative area, was it, yet. But you sort of think the rest of the world has figured it out, why can't we? And part of it is because we're not allowed to subsidize the rates in some way, like many retailers can just charge everyone 5% more, offer that service, and it's a wash. It doesn't look like it costs you anything, but it really did.
So for that reason, we couldn't do an auto debit program like we already do with the electronic.
But I'm still optimistic that someday we'll just send everyone a quarterly or a monthly statement of all the charges.
That'd be great.
That'd be the best way. Quarterly would be ideal if we could afford the cash flow. But it's not there yet.
Okay, thank you.
On EF4, the sewer budget, as I said, the MWRA charge is very modest this year. You can see our local costs are really much lower. And I'll get into that. Most of that is driven on the next year. If you flip to EF5, there's a couple things I'll point out. In water and sewer, just like the general fund, for public works, longevity payments were eliminated. That's a small savings in this account. And also later on, clothing payments and other expenses were eliminated, collective bargaining. We had on the bottom of EF5, you can see the sewer retirement assessment under expenses, the second line. This year is actually almost $4,000 over budget. They did an an actuarial adjustment during this year, so that the next year is not really up 17%, it's up 4.5% over what it was corrected. So just to explain how that changed so much. Bill hates my decision, actually. On page EF6, we had some employees transferred between water, sewer, and the general fund and public works, so that's why health insurance budgets change around. It's not like health insurance premiums went down 23%, certainly, and you'll see water went up quite a bit. Can't read too much into that. I do want to spend just a minute talking about the debt changes, which are KCS10. We straightened out the MWRA change, and you'll see this in the warrant report, change their split of grants and low or no interest loans. So it's really a much better deal now. We're getting 75% grant instead of, I think, 45 or 55. So the debt service for FY16 and the future is lower, and that's one of the changes that I did make. So you see 126,000, I forget, it's 50,000 lower. We used to have a 50-50 split, and the MWRA makes funds available half for free, just here's the money,
yeah,
and half at either low or no interest, recently no interest. They changed that mix to 75% grant, so here's a lot more money.
Oh.
So they want to encourage you to fix your system so you don't have leaks. And naturally, we want that too. The more we leak, the more we spend. That's why the debt budget went down. Well, the next couple pages is the water budget. You can see right away on EF12, there's that health insurance account. And again, that's part of the transfers within the public works department. As you know, premiums are up 8.2%, so it's not that. I'll get to the debt shortly. Some employees were split between water and sewer. I think they counted all the water in this audit. It'll work out. And this budget also had a debt reduction, and that was explained just by cut the rates. We had been using 6.5% for a couple of years out, and I thought that was just way too high, so I cut it every year. But this was four in the out years. There's no other changes. Stormwater, for now it's really not much of a discussion point. Probably this summer or next fall, the selectmen will have to really sit down and talk about it. Flip to page EF, I can't read it, 24. It says capital and debt on the top of the page, stormwater enterprise fund capital and debt. So if you look at that bottom section, you can see 930,000. Declining. You know, you have $8 million worth of debt that is possibly going to be paid for. I very much mean possibly. There's two rivers, but three projects planned. I have been on the plan for a long time. You can see the funding in FY18 is to do design work, and that's when I said to Mark, there is some plan for using some of the reserves. There's $300,000 right there. But clearly, reserves and the current fees will not take those debt if this is carried out as it's been sketched out. Again, that's a discussion the select will have. I know past boards have very mixed feelings about whether to do the work and if so, how to pay for it. So, to be determined. But if this goes forward, you're going to see rates a lot higher than $40 an hour. So that really wraps up enterprise funds. I don't know if you have any questions. Good. I just want to go over
real quickly, only because so many of you asked before. Just in the last hour, I did a typical Reading home loan. That's a one-page full size. No reason to really go over this, but I just hand it out so you can start looking at it. It is kind of interesting. Property taxes are a little more than 70%. The last time we did this exercise, they were a little lower, just a little under 70%. So even a state aid that's just not keeping up. On the expense side, as you know, the budget doesn't change very sharply. There's really not a lot of change here in terms of percentage.
To your point, Bob, it might be very interesting to take a look on the revenue breakdown to be able to see more clearly the change in how state aid has come down.
You know, one of the reasons I stopped doing this, because I don't seem to like it. You think about the math, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. All right, so the assessed value is $464,000 for an average house, and the tax rate is X. That's easy. This is all mathematically factual. Next year, there's going to be a different assessed value and a different tax rate, and you can't compare the 2 years anymore. It's mathematically incorrect to do that, because it could be a different house. So you can say, well, let's just use a $400,000 house. Well, that's wrong, too. So unfortunately, this analysis does not lend itself to comparing. Do a snapshot, I can do the same snapshot next year.
It's like a moving target.
It's a moving target, and it's not fair to then start doing any statistical work and change to get a general sense. But you already know from the budget, the school budget is 2/3, town is 1/3, benefits are this, it's not a big deal. So that's something I wanted to be real careful about, because people start trying to make calculations that just aren't accurate. You know, it's kind of an interesting thing in general. I think what I can do is look at the percent of revenue derived from state aid, because we have that, unfortunately not in good format, but I have old town meeting warrants to go back 15 at least years. And you know, I know what that figure used to be, higher than 20%, it's just not hard. And property taxes were probably in the low 60% area.
Right. I'm looking at the other side, what percent property taxes.
And you know, it doesn't seem like that much, but that's $5 million.
Yeah.
It isn't there.
Yeah.
It is noticeable. Otherwise, if there's no more questions, we can go on to the warrant.
There's
a lot of FinCom business in this town meeting.
Okay.
In your picker packet, we'll start on page 25. Just to give you a little bit of background, next Tuesday night the selectmen are going to be asked to call a special town meeting. There's now two reasons for it, not just virtual lights. If you rewind, I forget which town meeting this was, I think it was January, we had an article to settle possible litigation. Remember, this is a Superfund site. Well, today's Wednesday. Monday, I got a call from our attorney that there may well be a lawsuit. So, since there now may be a lawsuit instead of it didn't look like anything too serious, we're going to put an article on the special town meeting just in case. And just so you know, the special town meeting is 8 o'clock, the first night of town meeting. It's not a big deal. It's a technicality. The reason I'm mentioning all this is because I'll go through both warrants, but after Article 4, which is capital, then we'll launch into the special town meeting to discuss whatever we need to discuss, if the selectmen call it. That's their choice next week.
So likely progression of town meeting would be somewhat similar to the traditional for the first night. We won't actually get to the budget, probably like the second night.
Absolutely, yeah. And I believe it probably will be a two-night town meeting unless the animal control bylaw makes it happen. It doesn't. On page 26, it's a huge percent of the warrant, and the changes are so minor. There will be more significant changes next November. Part 102 prepares according to the community. Anyways, page 26, I don't think anything has changed from when you got this 2 weeks ago.
I guess one thing did change. We talked a little more about the Birch Meadow project, and I reduced much more of it than I had previously. Basically, $1 million of the past project has gone away in expenses. I met with the rec committee last night, though, and I don't want to speak for them or get ahead of them. But it's certainly very fair to reduce the $2.3 million project to $1.5 million plus the $1 million lights. So it's $200,000 higher net.
Did you guys have more discussion about this last week?
No, I wasn't. No, I'm not.
Because I was just a little surprised we were seeing it in 15 when the presentation still sounded a little nebulous about what was being done. So I kept reading it thinking it was a typo. I'm confused why it's being put in.
We have so much money we need to spend it now. There's a couple ways to discuss it. First of all, it happens now. It's good in some ways. If it doesn't happen now, it's not the end. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but it's clear now that there's two parts to this project. So you have an opportunity to split into two if you want to. And the lights are clearly one part. You could also wait another year or two and do the whole thing then. Those are the two choices.
I sort of like the idea of splitting it. It just feels like the same grant.
And then the $1 million is, it's got a few pieces to it. It's a timing thing, so again, I couldn't say anything until recently. I hope you read my memo and understood that part. We could not do anything in spring and put it all off to November. There is some process, public process, the selectmen absolutely have to go through. They've already done some off the record, if you will, with a lot of the neighbors and abutters, but not all of them. They have to have a public hearing. If you look at the actual layout of Birch Meadow, probably only Morton Field affects abutters. There's five fields, three of them already have lights. The two that don't are one that's behind the cafeteria, that little league field. There's no abutters there unless you're in the cafeteria at night. And then Morton Field has a few abutters, but if you're already living in that area, the tennis courts are probably just about as bright as the field's gonna be. So I don't mean to minimize the fact there are impacts, but it's not huge. So there is that public process part that has to happen. This is an odd time of the year to ask the Board of Selectmen to do anything because of the elections. You don't want it looking like the old board is kind of cramming something in before they leave, so you want to kind of slow down a little. So this is something for the new board, and when we were doing all this, we didn't know who would run against who, so it turns out there's only one seat to grab, but it could have been two. So we really want to be careful about not having a lame duck board if you will approve something. So the whole of thinking all along has been, stretch this thing out, do it in May or June. If town meeting is uncomfortable if that hasn't happened, then they shouldn't approve this. But the thing of it is, it's relatively minor impact, and we can get the process going, deal with the impact, and not have to wait for another 6 months. It's just six more months of field usage. It's nothing more complicated than that. Whatever town meeting wishes, that would be obviously is fine.
So Bob, you anticipate that town meeting will be asked to vote on this before the public process has had an opportunity to take place.
And they will vote on allowing the debt to be authorized. They're not voting on anything else. The good thing about the plan is we will not borrow the money for another year. So we have the year to have a public process. If it really took the year, I can't imagine that it will. But there's no reason why the public process is going to sort of interfere in any way. And again, it's a timing thing. Are uncomfortable with this. Many capital projects work this way. You just don't really care about water mains and other things like this, where well before every detail is known, you ask for debt authorization. That's very common. It's a little different here because there could be neighborhood impact, but other than that, there really isn't any difference.
In the project, and the other difference though is that 2 weeks ago it was suggested as a draw for cash in 15, which inspired a little bit of reaction. And now there's an option, and I think it sounds like that's where you're leaning toward.
If it were free cash, I would have withdrawn it, but I have to show you something.
So that's a big change from.
Yeah, I would not think that using. And the other thing is the project is divisible. You could do portions of it. John Fito and I
companies have identified $400,000 higher priority out of the million. There would be no neighborhood impact, so you can just zip it right along. And that's an option, but if you were to say, do you want to use half a million or $400,000 in free cash? In December, I'd have said sure, but now, no. That's $2 million in hope between the portable classrooms, modular classrooms, and snow and ice. Now I don't think that's a good idea. And again, it's sort of a community discussion, a town meeting discussion. But the benefits of the lighting are phenomenal in terms of, you'll see some of the revenues when the selectmen hit. I don't mean to say it's going to pay for itself, but think of what it would cost to build a new field. And then we'll give you all the numbers about how much increase surface time this adds to all the fields that are there. It's staggering. So this is by far the cheapest way to add more fields, if you think adding more fields is important. And that's obviously the question.
If town meeting voted it down in April, would there be an opportunity within the next year for town meeting to vote again before the work would start, before any
staff
would have to?
I would say that would allow the selectmen to decide if they wanted the public process to go ahead anyways, or wait again.
And that might be what, depending on what they hear from town meeting.
If they hear from town meeting that they want the public process, then almost undoubtedly November town meeting, the same request would come in.
Okay.
And it would just have lost, half a year or so of athletic seasons. So again, it's not the end of the world. But it's easy for me to say that.
So it would, there would be some real...
You would cry right now on getting snow off of three turf fields in this community.
So there would in fact be...
It's supposed to snow Friday and Saturday.
I know.
So if we did, if town meeting didn't approve it in April, then there would in fact be a delay in...
Probably 6 months delay. And again, it's a choice. I don't feel extremely strongly about it. It's not a disaster one way or the other.
Okay.
It's a choice.
And that would still be faster than it had been.
Yeah.
As of last time this happened.
And from a financial standpoint, it's almost free in the 6 months.
What does that mean?
You're going to be paying $10,000 or $20,000 in short-term interest rate costs. That's cheap.
Will the selectmen do when he's going through the public process? Cause
they will.
I mean, sooner than later, because, I think it's good to get out there, because even though it's in the plan, I think just as we saw it, a week or two ago, we're all like, it was like, whoa, I've never even heard of this.
I know that two selectmen have walked some neighborhoods and talked to people already, but that's not formal. That's not a public process. That's an informal.
Right. Yeah, but I think it's important to get out there. So. I think it's a good project, but I don't think anyone has any.
When would the lights be? If it did, when would the lights be installed? Would you get the season out of it?
I don't really want to answer that, other than it's definitely going to be the distance between the two town meetings is what you say. I don't want to guess as to how fast.
Okay.
Not for the summer, I would have to think.
Right.
Certainly not the whole thing would not be ready for the summer. Right. That's a good part of it. Again, the portions of the three fields that already have lighting are the easiest, because where to put the poles, no wetlands and so forth. The others take a little more study.
Sure.
But I think the expectation is you'd certainly have a full piece in the fall. And if you wait till November, then you also miss the winter construction season. You're probably looking at more like a 9 month, so maybe you get next summer. Again, it's a choice.
Can you get the engineers involved?
The Army Corps?
Yeah.
I don't know. We could ask. Let's see. There's nothing else on 26 of this article that has changed. On page 27, there are a couple of things that are probably changed. Article 5. Again, we'll have just leaked over to a special town meeting, but let's pretend we get going. On page 28, I can tell you right now this page is already out of date, but nonetheless, we're using less free cash than the snow and ice alone costs, which is good. The snow and ice number absolutely will go up, and I just got a request from the library tonight that the $20,000, they want to ask for $40,000 for the long range sure I'll get it right up to give you next week. I think all the other numbers are fine, but expect to see snow and ice higher and then the library number higher, so free cash is gonna be over half a million. But still, considering the winter, it's not so bad.
What is the $20,000 for the library long-range plan, what is that for?
Every 5 years, they're supposed to do a long-range plan for their operations and file with the state. They're actually a few years behind, and they have granted permission to extend it because they're moving. So there's two purposes of it, which is why there's kind of two parts of it. And I'm sure I won't explain this as a library person would, but one of them is to fulfill what the state requires every 5 years. But in addition to that, they want to know, how do we run our operation in a new building? How do we staff it? What do we offer? So they really want to do, I'll call it an efficiency study. You know, and I think now's the right time, absolutely. They hope to get the results in time for November town meeting. That's what the trustees desire. And they desire to go to November town meeting and ask for staffing if appropriate, if the study is suggested. That way they have it in place already as they move in the spring. And in fact, they may, the position they've asked for, if they don't get it now and they get it next November, they will absolutely hire it before they the first operation. And beyond that, I don't know what the study may show, so it's really hard. But that's their intent.
Is this in the realm of what they spend with that, right?
They spent, I'm going to say, $15,000 last time, and then Ruth and staff did a lot of work. I don't know if they don't want to do the work, but they really want to get an independent view at this time and not have staff producing the document, which is probably a good idea. We have a quote from MAPC to do a good chunk of this work for $8,000, so I'm not sure we need the 40, but I don't know if the library doesn't want to use MAPC. It's kind of an, we use their, we're actually, during the state assessments, we pay a certain amount to be a member. It's a planning council. And we actually use them for a lot of economic development work we do. We get a lot of grants for them to do different studies. They're looking at our Board of Health. They're looking at our Human Elder Services right now. So they may not be experts at library. They're not experts at those other things either. They use a consistent approach, though. So that's to be determined as to whether they're used or not.
Will there be a, when we have record winter like this, is there going to be a correlation between the roads deteriorating faster? I know we've been talking about the DPW's already out straight and okay.
No, they're recovered now.
Oh, well, I thought with the West Street project, you felt like we were kind of
the engineers were out straight, yeah.
Okay.
But no, I've put in
the repair crews can still do more
potholes in here.
Yep.
I mean, that's a lot more than they usually spend,
okay.
But I'm sure it's not going to be nearly enough.
Okay.
Potholes, they'll find. 45 is expenses and 5,000 is in for wages, just for overtime.
Okay, so it's not our, like the hot pool type crew that's at capacity, it's the engineers that are at capacity? Oh, okay.
It's just a little more money on this too. For road repair, they released another 300,000 this year. And that's actually something I was going to get to. A year ago, for the last couple of years, 900 million, 300 million. Legislature. 200 million has been released by the governor and 100 million has not. That translates to 900,000 or 600,000 for radical. When the new governor came in, he released that extra 100 million from the current year, which gave us 300,000. And then shortly thereafter, he filed a bill for only 200 million instead of 300 million in current or next year, Chapter 91. So the good news is. Well, but it's, I don't think it's ever been spent. So the increase was a legislative increase that never got released. I don't think it ever got released.
I thought you just said he released
the rest. He did. So so spanning two governors, it finally got released and spent. Will be spent. But he did not carry on with the 300 million level in his future budget, which I kind of thought he would. But obviously the state's having some problems. So he did cut, if you will, 100 million out of that.
But the reason he filed it now to get it done now is if the legislature can agree on this quickly, you can actually hit the summer construction season. What normally happens is they don't agree till June, July, or August, and we miss a year. And so, you know, the thinking is by at least doing $200 million now, it's better than doing, you know, something that's going to be so late you miss the construction season. Our construction prices this summer will probably go up as everybody's roads are available.
Maybe they'll come from Michigan and I stand back.
Good news is we got the Western yard price locked in, so.
Yeah, County's kind of a mess, huh? County's kind of a mess, isn't it?
I know I get a lot more snow on my front. Yeah, I'm sure. They know where Pete still lives. Page 29, I think, is something we also discussed. That's the two-part sewer reserve use of $600,000. One of them is a station and one of them is some software. To move on to Article 6. We have received $150,000 that's now sitting in the general fund from smart growth payment from the state. This article would move that $150,000 into the 40R fund, and it would be just over $500,000. We have used this in the past. I've given some examples of technology and roadblock and sidewalk improvements. But right now, we have not planned to use any of that $500,000 for FY16 or beyond. That's an open discussion. But it is a source of money.
We use 40R for school technology.
It's somewhat of a formality. Yeah, you can time it, you can vote it for anything at once. We just had to match it up with line items for the certain dollars. That's what was used that year.
Is there still more of that?
That's a good question. Do you know? I think there's one more $150,000.
What was the question?
Is there more smart growth money?
The last time I checked, just $150,000.
I think
there might be more coming in, but I hadn't seen it
coming
yet, so.
I'm almost sure there must be one at Johnson
Woods. When I checked last time, I only saw the one.
There might even be two. There might be one. Seven is to move money in the current year budget to set aside for OPEB into the trust. In a different time of the year, we probably could have put more into the trust since we do have pretty good surplus in health insurance premiums, but you know, I think we have to use that to build pay for some of this. So I'm just going to follow along with the plan of what was budgeted, which is fine. But just to remind you, in the general fund, we're only meeting about one quarter of the annual obligation, so it's something that's going to have to be built someday.
After the discussion of not that it's okay to be like everybody else, but take a look again at how we're doing it compared to other people. Sharon, hi here.
You mean in terms of the OPEB?
Yes.
I think that we're kind of comparable with other communities, but you mean get another chart in here like it's last year?
Well, certainly to talk it through, I don't know if you need the chart to show up again.
I mean, there are communities that are not going to fund it until they've got their pension fully funded, and others that have, you know, started to fund it like we are funding it. So there's a mix.
Right.
Whereas a few years back, nobody was really doing much with it, and now people are seeing that it's such a big liability that we have to start doing something. It's just, you know, to wait till you're fully funding your pension is a lot of years. I mean, I think ours is 2028. If we wait for that long, it would be a long time. Could really start putting a dent in this. At least every little bit counts. The longer that money's in there, the more time it has to
run. Yeah, I think this, in my opinion, may be another one where we want to be riding the wave. We most certainly don't want to be.
I mean, we're certainly ahead of a lot. So.
Yeah, the other part that's a little tricky, though, is some communities have sped up their pension funding. So if you look at OPEB, you'd see zero. But they're taking care of pension faster, so they're going to get
the OPEB. Because they want to take that assessment for pension.
To your point, the selectmen had a similar discussion over the winter. The other reason it snowed is they said we did not increase the snow and ice budget. What was the point? Just like I didn't get my snowblower fixed fast enough.
The jinx.
any of the storms.
We got it fixed for the last storm, and then, so I went around and just did a lot of trimming in the neighborhood. Let's see, Article 8, I don't know if you folks wanted to opine on this, you can read it over. We have a policy the selectmen have adopted called Complete Streets. It makes us eligible for grants.
That's a good thing.
If the town meeting adopts it, then we're even in a better position to receive grants. It's not any more complex than that. We have a good policy. I don't know.
I like the idea of voting on it, because it shows.
It's an unusual thing to bring to town meetings, so I don't remember if I'm ever looking at something.
I'd be in favor of grants.
Just in the realm of trying to reach out to all sources of revenue.
So, kind of general opinion, do we want to opine on this one?
I think we should jump on grants.
Yeah.
Article 10 is the next one, and that's to allow town manager to enter into a longer contract for 3 years for solid waste and recycling. This is something we do from time to time. There's a similar article that will follow for selling hours. What probably will happen is a series of five-year contracts. In this particular case, the market is a lot different than it was 5 and 10 years ago. Back then, we were looking at gearing for 10% a year increases, and the markets turned out to be very friendly to towns. I'll let you know how the lawsuit works out. I don't know. There's a demand for it. Don't ask me why there is. Part of it's there is a demand for fill for real estate projects. How much this plays into that, I really don't know. I wouldn't see a direct relation, but maybe there is to have landfills, to have a compost.
Is this the compost pipeline?
No, this is the trash haul.
Okay.
And much like another article, there is no contract town meetings voting on whether it's a good or bad idea. You have to give the town manager authorization before you can even negotiate it. And this will be done in the board of selectmen in the executive session, I'm sure. Article 14, this same idea, but this is cell towers. You have two locations in town that are really good candidates. One has stuff, one does not. The water storage tank on Auburn Street currently has, I'm going to say, 3 vendors, and a 4th one wants to join. In order to repair the water tank, which includes painting it later, everyone had to get their equipment off. It cost a fair amount of money to take their equipment off and to build a temporary structure because they still want cell coverage. And they really want to renegotiate and extend their leases, which are up in 18 months. So they're simple as they want to amortize the cost of doing this over the, whatever, 10 or 20 years. So we've had town council looking at this for 6 months, actually. I'm pretty confident that we can improve our revenues, let's just say, from the situation. But again, we have to get permission from the town meeting to enter into longer than 3-year contracts or there is a second location in this article and not allow that yet, geographically. So a second location will get a full public process because it doesn't have any cell towers on it now. We all kind of abutters notices to the extent there are any, and we'll have a really very public discussion. It's possible that that can come to the November town meeting, but that's probably a little optimistic. Maybe we'll see it in here. But the point is, both myself as a selectman especially, have been really working on revenue ideas. We're not going to get rich with this stuff, but. Disposing of things, hopefully appropriately. I guess you'll find out. Just so you know, whatever procurement policies we've had as of when our MLD issue has sprung, we have changed nothing. We had some ideas to change. We said, we better not change a thing. So we'll talk to the procurement expert at some point and get everything that's changed. Article 16 is the sewer grant loan program I told you about.
Yeah, that's awesome.
30, page 35. It used to be 45% grant, now it's 75%.
So is the amount like $991,000 roughly? Is that what I saw in there?
There's a couple of allocations of 844 each. But there's a lot of different phases that go on consecutively. So it really depends.
Was that all predetermined? It's just like how we're going to get the money, or do you have to go through a process every year? I didn't know where that number came from.
It is predetermined, but that's an interesting question. I can't remember how. I don't know if it's purely on your allocation or your assessment, rather, or whether there's some other metric they use. I really don't know.
So we couldn't like go and ask for more?
What we have done is asked for all of the future allocation right away. So when we look at the water things that I just got a list a couple days ago, Reading and two other communities out of 50 have zero, because we've already asked for it and got it. There's a water main work.
Mm-hmm.
So for the next 5 years, in theory, we get zero. For sewer, you're not really allowed to ask in advance because they approve these one at a time and they're not very large. For water, I can't remember what we asked for, $3 or $4 million.
Yeah,
like
right.
Well,
so we have to
just
work in advance, and 0%
loan,
right?
Yeah.
Right.
So did we sort of screw ourselves?
No, we just got the money sooner. We're using it.
Okay, so it's not that that would work for higher grants.
No, that was water. And in sewer, we've never had the opportunity to sort of get it in advance. It's always they don't let out.
Okay. I think it's funny the way they it's not like one bucket. Shift it between water and sewer.
Yeah, it's interesting where it's both them that are ready to run pretty differently for whatever reason. Bill's article is page 36, article 17.
I just wanted to say
Bill's article.
Forest Cemetery.
Bill's
trustee.
Cemetery.
What date is your opening notice? I forgot to tell you.
13th.
It's going out on the weekly notes 10 or 12 days before, just so you know. There is an open house.
And I still haven't found out who's on from the FinCom.
Yeah.
The gentleman forgot to call me last week. I won't mention his name. But you're all welcome to come up.
What are you serving? The 10th of April?
So you got to make the same joke again, don't you?
What's that?
You got to make the same joke about the open house.
Oh, feel free to drop in.
So the 13th is a Monday?
No, it's a Saturday.
Saturday.
Okay,
Saturday.
So
it should be a Saturday.
So it's the 11th or?
Might be the
11th.
Yeah,
because the 13th
yeah,
is a Monday.
Whatever the Saturday is.
Yes.
We were going to have it the 18th, but that's
so it's
vacation.
The 11th.
Oh, okay. People are dying to go.
Some of the trustees are going to dress up in Halloween costumes. So. We open the tomb and have a
bowl of cowboy now. Cemetery trustees and the town manager have slightly different views on this, as you can read.
Yep.
But I certainly respect their interests. Totally what they're doing.
And by the way, it goes back to 1983, this whole problem started.
Really?
Yeah. When we sold the TAS property.
Oh.
Yeah. And the original DPW garage at that time was supposed to go on where Staples is now. And the Industrial Development Commission felt that it was too valuable to sell for that, so they had to scurry around and get the land across the street. And the chairman of the Industrial Development Commission at the time was a fellow named
Was he also working in task at the
time? Yes. Yes, he did.
Interesting.
Well, only till they got the building built. But, so it's
a long time.
And this is one of his
what is the your name, Attorney General, as it relates to the permit? No, it's not approved yet. So I keep pushing it out on selectmen's agendas because it's certainly not appropriate to discuss as opposed to approve. So it's going to sit on the May agenda at this point. And by then it should be approved or not. I wouldn't.
I think when you get down to the difference between the philosophies, Bob's and mine,
I think it's operational. Certainly it's going to cost you the same amount of money when you build a separate building, similar, not the same, similar as about $400 a square foot, whichever way you go. Just a case of operation. We are combined with DPW down at the present site. I suggest it'll cost us $12,500 a year. That guy's writing the trucks, we have absolutely nothing. We have no other snow plow, and there is no integration with DPW. We don't take, because we only have four full-time employees, we're not able to take people from there to go help and dig sewers or water mains or anything else.
Actually, that's where Bill and I don't agree. I think the difference is more than just money and operational. There are water main breaks and sewer breaks where it is all hands on deck.
I know.
And snow, you're right, it is all hands on deck. So I think, again, money aside, we don't know what the money is, we'll find out. For morale, it's much better to have the whole department in one location, have them be able to work together. Even though they all have separate functions most of the time, there are those times when they don't.
And the other thing is, if you've got a building in one of the cemeteries, you only have to transport to three. If you have it down with DPW, you're going to have to transport to four. And that's kind of the lost time factor comes in. At some point in time, we're going to have to put on another employee. But if you still have inefficiency, you're still paying for inefficiency.
Just for the newer FinCom members, Bill will quote the exact number. It is really interesting if you look back at the time, DPW at one point had 125 employees.
Yeah.
Technology and equipment have improved. Some things you need people to do. So there's no question DPW does not have the capacity to do the work it used to have, even with good equipment and good people. It just doesn't.
You know, that's true in many communities, not all of them.
Right now, because of the new equipment, they can't put both trucks in the building.
At least we measured the fire engine.
That when they built the DPW maintenance, the ladder truck would not fit in it, so.
Yeah, one of the needs for the DPW site and garage itself is because of the equipment. Cemetery garage has the same problem, but it's a bigger problem down at the yard where, all right, so you have a lot less people and you have a lot bigger equipment and more equipment. Whoops, we have the same building. So it hasn't really been sort of well planned out, I'll say. It's been sort of, let's deal with it one year. It's time to take a big step back and really think about options.
And when they were thinking going on where the Staples is now, that was 8 acres. They gave up 15, they went to 8, and then with the present DPW site is 6. And at that time, they were talking about bringing administration down with 2, and because of the increase in size of the lot, we can't do it. And the latest one that Wesson and Sampson had that I saw, rendition for down there. They had 52 parking spots, however, 65 open part-time employees. So where do you put the other 13 employees? 6 of which would be cemetery people. And we got plenty of space.
So did town meeting get the results of the studies that we paid for? I can't remember.
No, but no reason town meeting would have seen it. The select would have seen it.
Okay, so really a presentation hasn't been made to town meeting.
No, I suppose one could be made in this article.
Because it looks like it's either $2 million or it's like $22 million.
Well, Bill is, I'm sorry, the Board of Cemetery Trustees has asked for $2 million just to do across the street. And, you know, that may or that may not work out.
Okay, and then who made the decision that really, or who made a strong recommendation that land is so valuable we might want to encourage business to invest there, not remove ourselves?
My point of view is that this belongs to the new building committee.
Yeah.
Just $2 million on its own merits does.
Yep.
But there's a big gorilla down there that's going to be much more expensive, and it really needs to be looked at as a master plan.
Yeah.
Including whatever the options are. One of them is absolutely to stay where they are, but another one is not to stay where they are.
So would the building committee then look at the school space working group is looking at locations. So would the building committee, in your opinion, be authorized to look at locations?
A building committee normally would not look at, here's a project. So that's why in this case, what I've suggested is the selectmen, FinCom, and the building committee work together. It's this economic issue.
Yeah.
It has many different sort of parts. It's a complex one because you don't want to have those three groups meeting executive session.
Okay.
So it might have to be subcommittees or something. But if you're talking about real estate acquisition, that's executive session.
Or what about like our sewer, where our sewer plant used to be?
A water plant?
Yes, or a water.
That wouldn't be enough for a garage, certainly, but there are a few locations. If you really wanted to split up DPW and be in three or four locations, including a secondary garage, you could do that. Again, I don't like the idea, I'd rather be in one place, but it's possible. And that would be one of the locations you could be. I don't think the neighbors would be too keen on it, but you could.
That road would not have a lot of traffic.
No, it certainly has to be approved.
Yeah, gotcha.
By the way, the school working group is on hiatus pending a number of issues. The school committee had discussions on long-term plans and the formation of the long-term building permanent.
Weston Sampson does recommend the Stroud Avenue site.
Yeah, so, thanks. Quick question on this. It mentions here that the debt begins in 17, but it looks like it's actually cited in 18 on page 10 or 11.
I think the debt payment may, yeah, so you generally need to do.
If we start at 17, then start the debt payment.
Yeah, okay. Anything else on this one?
Yeah, I said, we've got Bill here, so if there are questions in particular, it's a great time to ask.
Yeah, just to be clear, I don't dispute any of Bill's facts. They are facts. He's exactly right. Something needs to be done.
Now, the building cost came from Josh and Ed Morris.
Okay.
Because my board didn't want a false figure. And we wanted not to be able to remove one, unlike another building in town. See, we put a roof on everybody we put in. We require it.
No, each nail goes in, right?
No nails. Self-sealing. I sincerely think, you know, we do need a building. That thing is, well, and along with Bob's saying, the building committee, I think we could have come in at 1.7 million and avoided the committee. But I think that would have shown town meeting, hey, what are you trying to do?
Are you talking about building this across the street down there?
Well, there's two options, I think.
Okay.
What's that?
Oh, I was just trying to figure out, so we already own like these land out there?
Right now, there's, in my opinion, there's only one location. Our own engineering did, 5 years ago, they went around and evaluated six sites.
Actually, they are actually kind of consultant. Consultant did it within the last 2 or 3 years.
Yeah.
And worked on two sites.
Yeah.
And brought it to the selectmen,
Well,
actually, they had four sites in the selectmen area.
Yeah, and we also voted on two sites. One which would have been the present site and the other one as far as when. The one at Laurel Hill, unfortunately, because of the depth and everything else, you cannot get 4,000 square foot of building on that site. You can on Forest Run because I've got a modular home that I built on that site wonderfully and fit everything the boys want in the building. And also, I think we got to change our way of doing business a little bit too. In that, right now, he has open trailers to haul his lawnmowers on. I see no need of that. A closed trailer, you can put the equipment in the building and leave the trailers locked up and leave outside. Put two trailers inside, it's going to cost you $200,000. Leave them outside, you don't have to build a building to cover. And in due respect to Bob Keating, he also runs the parks department. An open trailer is great because he's hauling different stuff every day. He may be hauling a lawnmower one day, a scraper the next day. So, yeah, that's different. He's on the cemetery side, hauling the lawnmowers, and then in the fall, he has the sweep up of these. That's the only variation of equipment that he has.
Bill raises a very interesting and worthwhile point. I don't know where this goes, but if you think of the schools in the town,
out when they remodel facilities, it's very grand, you know, athletics and recreation and almost disaster areas. That's a real big issue.
And other than the building above, between you and John Dougherty, you should work on an agreement, who's gonna take care of that building? We're the only building in town that's not covered by facilities. I don't know where that.
We're working on a trade.
Well, that's what happened to us last time.
Trying to give them you and money.
Throw in a draft pick.
The discussion we had was that a new building, absolutely. The old building, tell us what it is, and, you know, they don't wanna work on it, obviously. It's gonna be torn down, so.
Yeah, Bob's had to invest, we've had to bring about $3,000 worth of doors. Because we were anticipating, as you know, Bob, going and getting a new building, and that thing fell through, so we had to fix what he has. And right now, quite frankly, needs a new water line.
Yeah, I agree, it really takes a step back and really needs to have a big discussion about what's going on here. The day of slapping together simple solutions.
And you're offering it down to DPW, it's great, but I think you're gonna end up with the same problem down there. They're all crowded right now.
Yeah.
No way to put all our equipment down there.
Always build up.
But I'm not gonna go away to this building also.
All right, then.
Unless I use one of the lots, I still have a lot more to go.
So I don't know what the rest of you all, but I'm feeling like that you gotta wait for the building committee, and I like Bob suggesting, I don't think you're far enough around to know if it's a lot, if this is the right solution. I don't feel like I can vote on this, because I don't feel like everybody's in agreement that we have a plan that suits the town. I like Bob's suggestion.
What's that?
That, that we have the finance committee and the selectmen.
And the permanent building committee?
Yep, collaboratively, which is unfortunately would delay it a bit, but I feel like you're gonna get, I feel like there's too much that we're asking all these questions and we don't have definitive answers and definitive agreement, so I feel like it would be too early to say, go ahead and spend money on this. And I'm not debating that, you're absolutely right, this, we need to do this, we need to fix this mess.
There's no debate. As long as we're part of the debate.
Bill, I suspect you will.
She might be sitting like a dog before that, when they go.
Yeah.
Anything else on this one?
Name the building after you.
Not to your six cents. 6 feet down, six years there. That's a policy. No, it would be, if it goes as far as Glenn, it should be named the final building. Because he was a former public works director and sold the land.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Part of the land, not all of it.
Okay, the next one is the annual housing allocation plan. I did update the balance, like $1,000 or something.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you, though.
In terms of sources of revenues, I've just mentioned it. This does allow us to use a small portion of the $260,000 for administration. We did just hire a regional housing services position shared with three other communities. So in theory, we could have asked for $10,000 out of this and had every right to do it. So that's still an option in the future. We've talked to the Board of Selectmen about this, and we could really be as a funding source for this. There's no funding source for it. Why you could spend it on things that are promised. And that's a future discussion we have.
It's a weird.
Yeah.
And it does have a $45. I mean, if there is a reason to.
Yeah, and Oak Tree can use $200,000. We do have a pledge to replenish some of it. I think it's $35,000 a year times 5 years for the memory care nightmare place up on Main Street. So that will be $400,000. source of annual funds would be awfully nice. Obviously, we're not in a position as a community to just take, you know, general fund levels and not bring it down. That's something to think about.
So the recommendation here is?
We just renew the plan. We just renew it every year. It's no change from last year, other than the dollar amount in it is updated.
Do we know what the consultant?
Yeah, I have all that online. This is, Reading's unusual. Reading designed this before there was any state law. Consultant suggested you abandon what you have and go to state law. That's just really simple.
And what would be, you go to state law?
Right now, if we want to use money out of this fund, there's a joint meeting between the Board of Selectmen and the Housing Authority and the majority vote. Scrapping the current method would institute a new board, Board of Directors, then have that majority. Exactly. Yeah. So if you have the funding source. The next article is the revolving funds. Change in here is the name of the Community Services Department. It has changed to Public Services. Just to point out what I suggested back in Article 5, you see that inspection revolving fund? Let's look at the balances in here somewhere. $782,000. In Article 5, I have the authority to spend up to $200,000 a year on certain things that are listed here. I've asked town meeting to take $140,000 and offset snow and ice or whatever, however you want to look at that. $700,000 is certainly a good, strong balance. And that $140,000 would be the $200,000 annual spend limit. We've already spent $60,000 or will spend $60,000 offsetting some of our public services budget costs. I had gone to the Economic Development Committee about 15 or 16 months ago asking for a spending plan of this, and I still haven't heard, so you know, I don't feel bad about starting to spend some of it.
So this is actually FY15, this is current year?
It is, and the way Sharon does her accounting, $60,000 of the asked for in FY16 must be used in FY15 to provide a source of funds. So that would leave $140,000 of the asked for. Otherwise, that's just a renewal. Just as an update, there still is no action out of the town force committee in terms of selling timber. Article 20 is the budget. I have a voting sheet for you next week. And Article 21 is just whatever Chapter 90 funds. Takes us to the special town meeting, which starts on page 43. There's effectively two important articles. One is the Bridgeboro lighting situation, and the other is this potential litigation that I really have nothing to add tonight. It's just a placeholder. So there's the draft warrant that the selectmen will look at. They'll get this tomorrow. Article 5 is cut and pasted on the last time we did it at a town meeting. I don't know what state would be a month from now or whatever the town meeting. But if there's things to discuss on Article 5 at all, we'll be done with executive session with the select. So that's it in terms of vote warrants. Now, I will say, it gives you a really good idea of at least one of you and a couple if possible to come to the selection next Tuesday just to see the recreation presentation. Again, you know, you've heard my thoughts. It's a good idea when it happens. The sooner it happens will benefit people. It's almost free in terms of cost, but there is a process that has to follow. The selectmen will have a discussion about it. They haven't discussed this in public. And just to be clear, one of the selectmen, I would say, has a conflict of interest in this, Joan Halsey, a baseball team that plays on the work field, so he will not be part of the discussion. and that's one of the reasons I couldn't really go to the board with two open seats and John Halsey, that only left two selectmen to talk to, so you couldn't bring it up in a public meeting.
When is that meeting taking place? Was that Tuesday?
Next Tuesday, yeah. Next door, I think it's at 7:30. I'm pretty sure it's at 7:30. Maybe people think they might be interested in the people.
Or watch
interested in
possibly
traveling.
So, you want to just quick raise a hand? I'm just trying to see if you can post.
Possibly, yeah.
So why don't we post just in case?
Okay, yeah.
And that's whatever.
Do you also need Caitlin to post you for Monday night?
Yes.
Which time would be a good for Monday night?
7:30.
I don't think scale one is 7 o'clock.
Yeah, 7 o'clock, sure.
Probably 7 o'clock, if you're just for the subcommittee.
Okay.
I have a feeling that that's busy night. I'm looking to find your room, so I'm going to use my office.
Three of us in a hall.
Got room for that. So that's it for the warrant. If there's any information you feel that you need, advance it next week. Got another one to ask. The snow and ice number that I'll give you next week, probably will have one storm worth of cushion. Right now, that number is not that much. Any sharing said for about 750 or 800.
About 750, yeah. The record.
Normally, we like to add in one storm worth just so we're not coming in for a reserve fund transfer because two storms would be part of your reserve fund. So, be aware of that next Saturday.
Is this snow?
This ain't a lot.
I thought it was worth it.
What?
Maybe enough to do something.
14 inches.
Two, no. three.
Oh.
Wow. I heard the same thing
you did. You heard the same thing?
Yeah, okay. I heard the same thing, and I'm like, what?
Did you operate?
Yeah, I was like,
this side of the table. What else have we misheard
yeah.
tonight?
What's the scam
going on?
Facebook,
yeah. It was very
yes,
funny, actually.
I'm like,
yeah,
oh my God.
Yeah,
no.
I got pulled into that too, which is very funny. You see it?
No, I didn't see
it.
Like,
so
like
put up
like
a mask. Like, you had to read like the little print
out of the scam. But one more thing, guys. So, if Proctor's asked for any additional questions ASAP to him, that would be great. The other thing that needs to come from, if not get delivered by me at town meeting, is the FinCom basically presentation of the budget and the situation. And we've been talking about this very regularly, which is great. What I will try to do is have some kind of a draft pulled together, and maybe, if it makes sense, maybe this kind of a smaller group of people that might want to take a look at it with me, if that makes sense. I'm happy to share with everybody. I'm just thinking nine authors could be a challenge.
Four or less.
Four, yeah, right, absolutely. Because the number. So if anyone is interested.
And I know we keep talking about override, and I wonder if we should remind them and throw out the other only options that our Congress or our elected officials from the state presented, which were essentially pay as you throw trash and CPA. Just remind them, there's not a huge, you already threw out billboards, so.
and just so you know, the selectmen's feelings on CPA, because they have discussed it. Whether or not they're opposed because of the timing of an override. They don't want to muddy the waters. They think the override is the way to go. It's would not solve any big problems. Mm-hmm. Just so you're clear with that.
I think that actually
I'm pretty sure it would help us find like a giant
Well, it's not to say that we shouldn't do it, but I think it's
yeah,
the point.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think handling one giant thing at once probably makes very good sense.
Mm-hmm.
And Mark and I chatted a couple of days ago, and the idea came up with priorities above what's been asked for, and I'll just share with you what I asked all the department heads and assistant department heads. I said, my idea is to fund, any additional funds would go towards the paying class shortfall. If anyone else has any ideas, please let me know. No one has any other ideas. That's the only thing that matters to me. Now, the library may come in and tell you differently next week, but did not tell me. Say that we're going to probably turn back, and it's not the town meeting warrant. We're going to probably turn back at least $200,000 of unspent wages this year. We have worked short staffed on purpose because we know what the budgets are going to look like. So if you really want to make a mental leap, is $200,000 coming to free cash kick back 50 a year for 4 years, it could go a long way. So, I'll just throw that out there. But responsibly, I don't really want to spend a lot of my cash on that. I don't think we're really anxious to spend a lot of free cash. The department heads that I spoke to about this all agreed that there's other needs, there's things, but you really gotta build the foundation of the house properly first. We don't have the best foundation. And that's largely my problem in future budgets, but that's also my priority. So if there's anything else you want for next week, please ask.
In your packet on the, right before the meeting minutes, is a quick note that I received from the library. That I would pass on to the residents, which is discussing their budget and our requests specifically.
It's
from Kate. It's a memo of Kate on the top. It's kind of right off the EF page.
It's in the other packet. It's like second last. So could I take from this that to provide level services for the library for the upcoming year, $4,709 would be sufficient for that?
That's what the Board of Trustees is saying.
Okay.
Compare that to the other figures of the superintendent and I gave on level service.
Yeah, I think that we suggested that there was a certain amount of free cash that we felt we could allow for spending to get as close to level service as possible. And I don't think necessarily that we got level services for everybody, but I think everybody did the best they could within the numbers that they had.
It would have been really scary if we couldn't use free cash in the last year. Just imagine for John to find $1 million and maybe kind of $500,000 or something. She's not working. Well, is it a rough winter, but we'll see. Sharon will do.
Meaning for the summer. For the schools and the snow, for the modulars and the snow.
We probably won't have, I say this every year.
Right.
We probably won't have more free cash after this summer.
Yeah.
Compared to last summer. Mm-hmm. But I've been wrong for at least 3 years.
Maybe I should just keep saying that. Back around the corner for a second. Are there some three or fewer people that would be willing to work with me on kind of first draft and kind of work with me on the words?
I'd like to sit in on that. Even if I'm not considered officially an author, but I think it would be very.
That's where the rub comes.
We're limited to four.
Yeah, we have to stay to
three. Okay.
Well, if you'd
like
to
do it by email, just please stick to four unless the same four.
Yeah, if you've got four, then another four.
Right. Why?
Now you can write two competing pieces of documents.
And the backbenchers. So I said like five people. Are there?
I'll step back.
I also, happy to step back if Vanessa would like to step in.
You can send us a draft, right? But we
yes.
can't well, reply to all. We
you,
could call you specifically.
You should include me and I should forward things.
Okay.
So send everything to me. I can send it out to all of you. Please don't discuss it on email.
Don't reply to all.
Even the four of us.
Right. If it was five, four, then I shouldn't be doing anything. Four, if you just correspond with me, or Kate, it doesn't matter, and then we'll send it to the other board. Just produce a document that has comments. Don't make comments in email. That's the best way I'll give it.
All of those documents will then they be posted online or
in the budget, in the annual budget, there's a 1-3 page FinCom report that Mark talked about. Plus, he stands up then, or the chair stands up in front of the town meeting and gives a report under Article 1, which normally is pretty much the same as what's written.
Right. But the drafts won't, with comments won't, that's not...
No, that's, I mean, technically it is public, but it's not going to appear anywhere. But if anyone ever wanted to ask the board, then this public.
Sure, we don't have to, because it's not part of the meeting, because we're not deliberating as a body.
It's not part of the minutes, because it's not part of the meeting, but it is public. Everything that's sent.
Sure, sure.
Unless there's a lawyer.
Litigation, or...
Pretty much anything with a lawyer is protected.
So if you were not, if you keep talking about this lawsuit, but you can't talk to us about it, keep making...
I don't know much, honestly, in this case. It's the same as what we heard about last fall, and then it sort of went away. Now it's sort of back.
As a new person, can I ask for what little information you do have?
There's a Superfund site far away that back in the 1970s, a trash hauler we used took some ready trash to it, and it since was contaminated. So the question is, was it ready trash? And this hauler, among many others, were sued by the EPA, and now this hauler is looking for other people to share that pain with. Mm. So that's it in a nutshell. But it's a long time ago. Record keeping was not perfect. So it really just on a conference call Monday just came back as a possibility. And Ray knew we would probably be having a special town meeting every month or two, so just to throw it out.
No, but seriously, are we going to have any white summer thing?
It would be impossible.
Are they going to be anywhere between? Okay.
I can't imagine why. But next fall, you know, if something happens and we need a town meeting, almost for sure we'll wait until September or October. You're not going to do it in the summer. We have had a lot of special town meetings.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So
as long as it's short and sweet. I mean, I know everyone can't. Well, did you see this list of people that are
special town meeting is something that absolutely cannot wait until the next town meeting. Or it's something you want to set off from the town meeting, like the charter. The charter could have happened in November with zoning, people would come out of their minds. Mm-hmm. So we thought we better offset that by a couple months.
I was going to say, all these precinct people that are in trouble for not attending downtown meetings. We don't have a list.
Yeah.
We don't usually have a list that long.
Yeah. No. A lot of town meeting sessions.
All right, let's take a look at the minutes, which are the last. Third paragraph, just to clarify, those account of 200,000 savings in which FinCom should consider reducing, let's add the words, the use of free cash to, I think, have $1.5 million in fiscal, this is actually fiscal 15.
Okay.
vote on your correction before we vote?
Just say it.
As amended?
As, okay.
He says.
Corrected.
Karen, are you a non-voter?
I'm gonna abstain because I was there. But it'll be good to shake it up.
8-0. Anything else? So we're set for 7:30 here. I think we'll have some people coming in, although I don't imagine they'll be comfortable at this point, but I guess we'll see. It's gonna be a tight one.
Most town department heads will come.
Will come.
I don't have, unless we need four, five. I don't know if John's bringing principals. He occasionally has, but hasn't recently used. It's not a controversial budget, so I don't think you'll have a lot of unknown. I'm not expecting people turning up.
Right, I think we can do is have them in the bike issue.
If it comes to that, absolutely.
Yeah.
Instead of going down.
Oh, yeah, recreation people show up. That's a very isolated vote.
Right.
But I think it goes along for sure.
Okay. All right. Any other business? All right. And a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All those in favor?
9-0-0.
Yeah.
9-8.
So we didn't, we don't know who, we haven't given Vanessa an assignment yet. I'm sad about that.
Let's do that at the next meeting.
Her assignments. Let's do liaison. Okay. Sure.
Thank you.
I'm still trying to understand all of them.
I know.
After these meetings, I have to Google all a bunch of terms. Will we try to, like, all the, let's say, library, schools, cemetery, public, what was it, recreation department?
Some vested interest?
I don't know.
Most of those go one way.
Not enough time of day or not enough money.
I.
Yeah, I saw that number and what.